now for a look into the future. Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me tremendous pleasure to introduce our 2015 President, Dave Tyson, CPP.
Good morning. And welcome. Mr. Chairman, Board of Directors, past presidents, volunteer leaders, headquarters team, members and guests. Thank you for being here this morning, and thank you for the extraordinary work you do every day on behalf of ASIS International. Your service is deeply appreciated by all who benefit from your efforts. With that as a backdrop, I'd like to take a moment to thank our 2014 President and current Chairman of the Board, Rich Whittup, CPP, for his leadership this past year, which he did both through personal and professional challenges he experienced, and he did so with unflappable poise. I was extremely fortunate to have worked closely with Rich on several issues, and I can attest that he's a consummate professional. We all have truly benefited from his talents and skills. Thank you, Rich, for your leadership and guidance and commitment. Thanks. Ironically, it's because of the influence and mentorship of a number of past presidents that I stand here before you today. Over a decade ago, I had the fortune of meeting and working with past presidents Spivey, Williams, and O'Hara. And while I benefited from the advice of many past presidents, these three were instrumental, each in their own way, of helping me develop both as a security professional and as an ASIS volunteer. Jeff was instrumental in helping me grow my connections and sphere of influence. Tim, in convincing me, in his own special way, to get more involved and providing executive level counsel. And Ray, a steady, encouraging voice through the years. I'm eternally grateful for their support and guidance over the years. Thank you. To all past presidents, board members, and volunteer leaders, I say that the tradition of developing, encouraging, and mentoring members or volunteers is some of the lifeblood of volunteerism in general, and more specifically, this society. By your enduring commitment to our society, you have endowed us with the financial strength, sense of vision, and more importantly, the heritage of making a difference in our profession. My thanks to each of you for bringing us to this point in the journey. For over 60 years, we have routinely passed leadership of the society on to a new leader. But we continue to understand that the stability, endurance, strength, and success of our society are based on our underlying volunteer and headquarters leadership teams, collectively working for the ideals of the society. I'm honored to be your 61st president. I commit to you today my vigorous dedication to our members, our society, and our profession. The excitement of making a positive difference in our profession awaits each of us this year. And I say to our president-elect, Dave Davis, CPP, it's only 12 short months, Dave, and it's going to happen a lot faster than you think. So get ready. I would challenge every one of you to engage and make 2015 a year of growth and optimism. Your society needs you, your energy, your ideas. I want to thank you for your membership in 2014 across 51 regions with a member in 138 countries, a chapter in 72 countries, which results in 234 chapters, 95 of them being non-US. Most recently, your board of directors approved a charter chapter in Madagascar. The value of an ASIS membership has increased substantially over the years. In 2014, it rose again with the publication of several groundbreaking research reports and standards, the implementation of two new certificate programs in executive protection and assets protection, and the major revamp of print and digital formats of Security Management Magazine. In addition, the Wharton ASIS program for security executives was redesigned to be shorter and more affordable, and a new online graduate certificate program through American Military University was launched. This year, we introduced a new membership class for retirees, a lower cost method of accessing all ASIS webinars for one price, and a new website feature, Security Spotlight, to help you find resources on specific topics. Three new research reports were published this year by ASIS and the ASIS Foundation, providing unprecedented amounts of industry-specific data and strategic information for members to use in day-to-day operations, as well as in security industry forecasting and planning. A comprehensive study of the security industry, the United States security industry size, scope, and insights, trends, and data. A major metrics research report and security metrics tool were released in June by the Foundation. The ASIS Foundation partnered with the University of Phoenix to publish Security Industry Survey of Risks and Professionals' Competencies, a report to help evaluate professional competencies and identify emerging risks that may impact careers. Security Management rolled out a full-color app featuring all the content from award-winning print magazine plus extras, and it's available for a free download in the iTunes App Store and Google Play. The PCB rolled out digital credentials for the ASIS board certifications, which replaced the paper certificates that are issued to newly certified professionals and those recertifying. Collaboration between the ASCSO Roundtable and the American Military University has resulted in a new 100% online certificate program that is the first of its kind. The Business Essentials for Security Executive Program is designed to provide critically needed business and management education and training to a rapidly growing group of senior security professionals and those aspiring into the chief security officer roles. As well, the CSO Roundtable explored business opportunities in Miami, El Paso, Juarez, Mexico, New Delhi, India, and many others. In 2014, ASIS councils continued to explore continued their extraordinary efforts in helping to produce educational webinars and classroom programs. Councils also published dozens of newsletters and four white papers. ASIS Women in Security had a very busy year, and I'm very pleased to announce that the Women in Security Initiative has been approved for full council status. For 238 years in the United States, and for a millennia or two in the rest of the world, leadership has defined us as a species. Whether it's been to move forward or hold fast, take risk or defend, migrate to a new land or build foundations where we are, the winds of change have always been among us. Success was deemed by the ability to evolve. While change is truly constant in the global village, we all live in today the change we experience every day, one of increased velocity of business demands, the unprecedented impact of cyber technology on our personal and business lives, and the complexity and reach of the threats that face us in our organizations today. This accentuates the value of collaboration and education. The velocity of business is being driven by the need to seek and expand into new markets, deal with the impacts of mergers and acquisitions, and the continued impact of resource rationalization on our budgets. The impact of cyber technology cannot be understated. Cloud computing, big data, security analytics, the Internet of Things, even drones in the air in our day-to-day lives, all underscores the new reality of advanced technology impacting our world. The business and technology changes continue to drive an ever-increasing complexity for security professionals in protecting their assets of companies. I believe this signals a new operating paradigm where security professionals, even 5 years from now, will have no choice but to understand the basics of cybersecurity. Not technically, but tactically. Where can they apply good, sound risk management principles, a little bit of the cyber lingo, and they can ask the right questions to ensure traditional security systems are protected and enterprise security risk management principles are considered. The U.S. Department of Labor indicated this year that by 2020, 66% of all cybersecurity roles will go unfilled. That's a staggering number. The ground is evolving directly under our feet, and we must evolve with a shift. This will create an unprecedented opportunity for those in our ranks who never considered a role involving technology, but have the courage to use the resources around them to develop and learn new skills, both personal and professional. These capabilities will fill an expanded role inside their companies of the future. So I got a little top 10 list that I wanted to share with you. Just food for thought. So, my top 10 for security professionals. 220 million tons of old computers and other technology devices are trashed in the United States every year. Has the data been wiped off of these and properly cleaned? Are those your secrets going out the door? On average, technology users carry 2.9 devices on them at all times. Do we have any idea what's on them from the company? And if it's secure? There are 350 million Snapchat messages sent every day. And for those of you who don't know what Snapchat is, it's an app that can send information one time confidentially to someone else. I wonder how many of those 350 million are economic espionage or data being leaked. There are 500 apps added each day to the Windows Phone Store. How many of these are introducing new risks to your company or key suppliers? What about data leakage? Over half the internet traffic in 2014 was from bots. Bots are robot computers that can be controlled to program and programmed to attack and steal information. Where will this bot traffic lead, and what will this mean for business in the future? I don't know, but it's definitely an impact. Facebook uploads 500 times more data than the New York Stock Exchange every day. What are the brand risks with this? As of April 2014, the average company has data in 759 cloud services. 80% of employees admit to using non-approved cloud systems for company data. How do you do investigations or e-discovery in that environment? By 2016, on our current trajectory, 54% of all devices moving data will be wireless. Are our company secrets secure going across those networks? By 2017, half of global employers will require employees to carry their own mobile devices. What happens when they lose them or leave the company? By 2020, there will be 30 billion in-home IP-connected devices with the Internet of Things. What's the potential impact to your company, or the data, or the computer systems? I threw in one bonus. I know I said 10, but here's number 11. Because I just love security analytics. All of the data in one place. Oh, great. Now it's easier to steal, and you got a whole bunch more breach concerns around privacy. Just look at IBM's Watson. It's video analytics for facial recognition. Any potential privacy risks there? So, Deloitte Consulting said this year that if a business sells goods to end consumers in North America and wants to grow appreciably, you will need to go into e-commerce in a much more substantial way. Let's think about the impacts to business today about going more online. What pressures does that drive with further use of cloud and social networking, mobile sales and mobile payments, not to mention the attractiveness of all of this to those who would seek to plunder the profits of those companies, intellectual property, and information on their customers. But clearly, it's no longer about the North American market anymore. McKinsey predicts that by 2020, 55% of all global GDP will come from Brazil, Russia, India, and China. It's predicted that many companies will move their headquarters to the developing world from the developed. Well, I cannot predict what this will mean for the industry. I can tell you that the most senior security roles for large corporations are almost always located at the corporate headquarters. So those who are CSOs, who aspire to be CSOs, maybe should take heed and learn a second language. Changing regulation in 2014 saw the enhancement of the Russian legislation known as SORM, or the System of Operating Investigative Measures, that allows much greater visibility to private companies' email and business traffic, as well as individual mobile device communications. EU privacy continues to evolve and grow and has reached a crescendo pace, so that it's now highly likely privacy will emerge as a new player, significant player in the United States, outside of the healthcare and breach concerns we have today. Well, business resilience, Ebola, bird flu, and intensifying weather patterns all made their mark in the world of 2014. 2015 shows no signs of changing, other than to remind us that change is constant. But there's good news. ASIS International is strong, shepherded expertly by staff and volunteers through a global financial crisis, hurricanes, a volcano eruption. ASIS events and education continue to deliver the highest quality and security training and know-how on a global basis. We have a board of directors that's second to none, and I am proud to work beside them at every opportunity. Our volunteer leadership is fully engaged, and this gives us a robust platform from which to operate and expand. Given the aging population of the world, our young professionals organization will give us strength for years to come. Standards and guidelines continue to be a beacon to the world of our expertise and resources as security professionals. The PCB ensures that we remain stalwart in our commitment to ensure integrity and focus on differentiating ASIS certified practitioners as proven competency in their field. Our regional advisory councils continue to expand and will endeavor to provide us with local insight and advice in continuing our globalization mission. During 2015, you will hear me speak about three things quite a bit. Globalization of our society, continued focus on expanding our reach in the world of cybersecurity, and the growing our membership by enhancing membership value. Not that what we do every day is not important, but just as professionals must evolve, so must ASIS to keep pace and lead. Globalization of our society and building our capability to truly globalize our programs will create significant member value and interest for new potential members. U.S. President John F. Kennedy once committed to putting a man on the moon within a decade, with no plan in place to get there. I believe we should be so bold. I believe that we should commit that within a decade, this society operates globally in multiple languages. I believe webinars and training programs should be able to be delivered in major geographies, not just replayed there. I believe membership in our high potential growth countries should rival the United States. It's difficult for anyone to deny the rapid evolution of cyber threat landscape, especially those charged with defending any type of information technology when within it. Threats have become more sophisticated and threat actors more organized, focused, and determined. Attacked capabilities are more destructive and more commoditized, with an entire ecosystem and marketplace making complex exploitation tactics available to the otherwise unskilled. We should continue to expand our cyber partnerships worldwide where this makes sense, and continue to grow our cyber education and resources for our members to prepare them for the jobs of today and the opportunities of tomorrow. Thirdly, we should have relentless focus on growing membership by focusing on member value and expanding our vision for the future. We must grow to evolve. We all benefit from a broader understanding of the world, and continuing to grow our population of members will benefit us all. These will be hard challenges to solve for, but if we work together on what is most important and dare to dream a little, I think anything's possible. In 2015, I have announced a presidential commission to study high potential growth opportunity regions and report back this year with specific outcomes in mind. This commission will be led by board member John Petruzzi, CPP. And I know with his dedication and focus, we will get great insight on future opportunities. I have quite a bit of travel this year with attending all of our major conferences, our 2015 conferences, obviously our 6th Middle East conference in Dubai, our 14th European conference in Frankfurt, and our 25th New York City conference in New York City, the annual seminar in Anaheim, and I've also planned trips to Dublin, Ireland, Vancouver and Ottawa in Canada, Mexico City, and our Asia Pacific conference. My friends and colleagues, I thank you for this great opportunity to lead our society, and I thank all that you've come before me in this prestigious capacity and given so much of their time and expertise. I thank our board of directors and all our volunteer leaders for what you do every day. Thank you.